thank you, Steve the Wozniak. Let's give it up from the room here and from all around Queensland via live stream. Toowoomba, thank you so much for your time. Cheers. Okay, well, how great was that? I know, pretty exciting. Our next session, or our next speaker in this session, is kind of, if you hark back a few decades, where the Woz was in his life then, if Steve Wozniak is the Woz, our next speaker hopes to be the will be. He's the guy who right now is at the beginning of that trajectory. He's based in Brisbane. His name is Bruce Dell. I'm not sure if he was born with that surname or he adopted a little computery kind of surname, a little stage name along the way. Bruce is the inventor of the algorithm that brings us unlimited data. That's the name of the product at Euclideon, his company in Brisbane. We're going to hear from this local entrepreneur who's developed this new way of rendering 3D images. I had a little go in his holodeck the other day, the kind of thing that Steve was talking about just now. So he's someone who's right at that point in his innovation and entrepreneurial activities where he's ripe to share with us some of the questions on being an entrepreneur, an innovator, and a disruptor. So would you please join me in welcoming Bruce Dell.
Good morning, everybody. I think I can use this. Okay, Australia is normally known as an exporter of food and resources. I think a lot of people think of us as a big farm and a big mine. But that looks like it's starting to change. China has made friends with its neighbors, the stands, Afghanistan, Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, and they've now got new sources of minerals. We see as other developing countries are becoming more competitive in producing food. So things are changing, and the governments of Australia are starting to realize this. And they say, we don't really want to go into just a big price war. We do not become rich and strong from doing that. Instead, if we can't compete on price, we have to compete on quality. Australia once made cars, radios, even computers. But as the developing world began to get better, began to compete with us, those are things that we stopped. America, on the other hand, made the similar things, cars, computers, radios, things like that. And when they could no longer compete with the developing world and manufacture, they said, rather than being the people who actually make the goods, let's be the people who invent the goods, who hold the IP. And I think that's the future of this country that makes things strong. The idea of a technologically advanced Australia is very strange to people. Queensland becoming the next Tokyo or becoming the next Silicon Valley, to many people, they say that's deluded. But just as Nokia turned Finland, a small little country in Europe, into the world leaders of mobile phones for over two decades, in the same way, we've secretly been making plans here in Queensland to make Queensland a major technology exporter. Euclideon is 50 people, and we're in Murarrie in Brisbane. We're an advanced 3D graphics company, or an advanced 3D graphics technology company. Normally in 3D graphics, everything is made of these little flat shapes called polygons. They're like little flat pieces of cardboard. Maybe you've seen games and things and said, that doesn't look quite round, it looks a bit angular. The game on the left is Crysis 2, and normally computer graphics look pretty good in games. You run very fast, and you don't notice things aren't so not so great. If you slow down and you have a look at them, you say, oh, that's not quite what the real world looks like. The picture here on the right is, it's not a photo, it's our technology. Rather than build everything out of these little flat pieces of cardboard, we found a way to build everything out of little 3D atoms, XYZ color in the computer. We weren't the first ones to find this. Medicine, sciences have been using this sort of technology for a long time. The problem is, every one of these little atoms takes up a certain amount of processing power. So the more atoms you have, the slower your computer will run. A while ago, I created a bit of controversy. I announced about 5 years ago that I had found a way to make computers run unlimited numbers of these little atoms. If what I said was true, it was the largest breakthrough since 3D graphics began. To put it into perspective, we build bigger computers to have more polygons or to have more little atoms to get better graphics. If a person says, no, you can have unlimited, you can have as many as you want, then we, like Steve Wozniak was talking about software getting smarter rather than the hardware getting smarter, it changes everything. At first, a lot of people said, impossible. I had to explain. It's a three-dimensional search algorithm, just like Google or Yahoo. They have, if you type in something like to be or not to be, it goes looking for those words on the internet. In the same way, I built a three-dimensional search algorithm that goes looking for points in point cloud data. It only takes exactly what's necessary, so it doesn't matter if something's small or as big as the Earth, there is no waste. This is now used in many different places around the world, the French railway system. In this case, we're looking at the Hungarian government. They've made one of the largest models in the world, 450 terabytes of geospatial data, where other governments will scan things. Where other governments have to leave their buildings all the time to check on things. In the case of Hungary, they've scanned everything in with a laser scanner, and with our technology, they can run entire cities, so they can check things very easily. In Tokyo, when there is a traffic crash, they need to put a plan in very quickly into place. And if they're able to see a real three-dimensional scan, then it helps them to put the right plan in place. And that's, once again, our technology that can run whole cities on even tiny little laptops. Computer games. A lot of people are excited about the idea of computer games that have unlimited power. Well, we're only just getting started. This here is a game that we're releasing soon, and it looks okay, it looks like other games, but there's a few differences. The animals you're seeing there are not made of polygons, they're a world-first new virtual life form. They're made of animated point cloud data. All the graphics, they weren't made by artists. They were made by us going down to the river with buckets and collecting rocks and sticks and leaves and things like this, and then we just scanned them in. There's always been the ability to scan things in, but never the ability to then use that in unlimited quantities. The biggest difference is not what you're seeing on screen, it's what's behind. This was made by 3 people in 2.5 months. If we have a look at how thousands of people are now put into making computer games, this makes a few big changes. There's a lot of talk of virtual reality helmets at the moment. 2 screens over your eyes, where when I look, the screens sort of change to what I would see from that direction. There are 2 ways of doing virtual reality. Think of it as like TV and the movies. The one is screens over your eyes. The other is a hologram room, a room that actually projects the things in the air, where you can walk around them, where the walls appear to disappear. They look like they're invisible, and you can see straight through them. Hologram technology isn't just science fiction. It does exist. Different science groups around the world have created such things, but it had some big problems. They always used a lot of computers, 80 computers, 100 computers. We did an experiment. What would happen if we took our technology that runs whole cities and we tried to make a hologram room run on 1 ordinary desktop computer. It was a complete success. And now we've realized that the technology that people were not expecting for a few decades, everyone thought we'll go virtual reality helmets, and then eventually we'll progress to hologram rooms. But that's coming a little bit earlier, and it's coming from Queensland. We are proud to say we make hardware as well as software. I'm like that. I think there's more respect for a company that produces its own hardware. When we saw the missing components of the hologram room, we said, well, we should build these as well. Holoverse. I suppose I should announce it here. We're opening the world's first hologram entertainment center on the Gold Coast. in a little over a month. And this is where we have 40 hologram rooms, and people can go and, do anything they can imagine, really. You can imagine how much we'll be building, moving into the future. I'm going to show you a small two-minute video of just some of the things that will be at Holoverse on the Gold Coast. What does this mean for Queensland? Let's just look at Brisbane. Brisbane is 2 million people. We have 4 paintball centres, 5 go-kart tracks, 7 laser tag centres, 8 trampoline centres, 18 bowling alleys, 27 children's play centres, and 38 movie cinemas. How many hologram entertainment centres of 40 rooms will we fit? We do not know. There could be as many as trampoline centres, 8 of them. There could be as many as movie theatres, 38 of them. How does that translate worldwide as an export from Queensland? There are 4,000 trampoline centres worldwide. If people like what we have made and we reach 4,000 trampoline centres, we'll be bringing $50 billion home to Queensland. We don't dodge tax. We're not one of those groups that, you know, put it all in Ireland and things like that. We like paying tax. With tax, we buy civilization. And we're very proud to be a part of Queensland and doing what we're doing. Thank you, Anastasia.
Please, Bruce. Over here, please, Bruce. There's no escaping it. We're going to have a little chat, you and I. Thanks so much. And I have to say, the Holoverse there looks a lot more like a kind of freaky horror show than it did when I was there the other day. But I can attest to the fact that jumping off the edge into the unknown is just as scary as it looks up there. So it's amazing how you can evoke the kind of emotional experience that the Woz was talking about earlier. So let's go back to the beginning. We've got about 10, 15 minutes. Yeah. How did you come up with this idea? Was it that you were trying to solve a particular problem, or where did you begin with the innovation?
Oh, hard questions.
I'm not Yarn Event. It's really...
I do not encourage this at all. The universities of Queensland are amazing, but I didn't pass and I didn't get into one. Mm-hmm. Without being able to go to university, problems that I normally would have been taught the answers to, I had to find my own answers to. Mm-hmm. And so that led us on a very, very different path. If I look at, oh, sorry.
No, so this, so the actual algorithms that you've developed here, this particular problem, the whole going from polygons to point data, so was it your background in being self-taught? Is that what you're saying? I mean, what was the moment that really made you tackle this?
I remember someone from ancient Greece said, what I cannot make, I do not understand. And I think for me, it was that all that freedom that one gets in Australia, I mean, we're a little bit less stressful here. Some countries, they say, we want to innovate, so we must push as much homework and as much stress on children's lives. I think that, that those who innovate need to have the sort of happiness, the sort of less stress that we get in different parts of the world, particularly here in Queensland. Mm. It's a good place.
Okay. How long did it take you to go from having this idea for an alternative using the science methodology in another way to make polygons hopefully obsolete in your world?
How 13 years, much to my parents' despair. What are you doing?
How old are you now?
What are you doing? 38.
Wow, so that was really, that's been a labour of love for, yeah.
Started at 17.
Yeah, that doesn't add up to 13, but that's all right.
No, I've had a company.
You didn't go to uni.
I finished it, and then we formed a company.
Oh, of course, okay. So what I like is that it's not just about gaming, because you said you copped a lot of flack when you first came out with this announcement 5 years ago. And, you know, I've read all the magazines and remarks. It's not just about gaming, and you were announcing it as a new tool for gaming. So tell us about what the other applications are for the tool. I mean, we've seen some of them there, and why, I guess more importantly, why it's important not to just, with something like this, not to just focus on gaming.
Well, when we talk about entertainment, we have two sides. We talk about games, and we also talk about what we call the virtual museum line of entertainment, going to the planets and things like that. We also do a lot of work in medicine. We work with QBI, Queensland Brain Institute, to try and solve some of the problems of visualization of medical data. We showed how our...
So doing the sorts of things they've been able to do in the past with masses of computer banks, but with smaller...
Our ability to scan brains and things is getting better, and the computers can't keep up. There is such a thing as $12 million supercomputers that people buy. We've been throwing our unlimited power technology at these problems. We'll reveal all of those in later years. But for now, yes, it's used in so many different areas. 3D graphics is a whole industry. And if you have a way to give unlimited power, then that applies to everything.
I think unlimited power is probably the phrase that's getting people going, huh? Because it sounds a little bit like a violation of, you know, the second, third, any of those laws of thermodynamics. So maybe it's the tag that's been your bugbear, but it's certainly very descriptive of what you're trying to do. So you've had interest from foreign investors, but you've been very clear about staying in Brisbane. Why is the reason for that?
My chairman of the company is David Merson. His former company was Mincom. The only reason why things went so well is he saw what I was doing, said I needed to support this with his friend Scott McTaggart from Mincom. We formed a company together. That was very good for me. I went from call centers and Target and things like that to having the top board in the Southern Hemisphere. So it worked well, but one of the conditions was, and I'm glad, you will stay here. Ah. And we like staying here. We have a very good team of people. And they all want to stay here as well.
Right. So it's actually coming from your board that you'll stay in Queensland.
I think all of us agree. Yeah. The good people that I have are very, very clever, as you can imagine. If they wanted simply more money or anything like that, they would have long been gone.
Mm.
But they say, we're the ones who are clever and we're staying here in Australia. We're glad we've formed a company to allow us to do so.
Yeah. And as well as that interest from David Merson, you've had Euclideon received a grant from the federal government's Commercialisation Australia initiative. So how important for young companies like yours really trying to get a go is investment and support like that to help?
It's very important. I imagine any company that's going to grow to strength is going to do this a few times.
Mm.
And without that survival, we probably would have been snatched up by someone overseas. So it's been very, very important to us.
Mm. Now, you haven't reinvented the wheel. You've said that you took the idea that was already being used in the heavy end science and medical work using the three-dimensional point data, and you've applied it differently to make a whole new approach to doing something.
We made it so we could have unlimited amounts of it.
Yeah. So what do you think is the key to using existing technologies in new ways?
Sorry, could you repeat the question?
Yeah, so what was it that let you... Where do you think that capacity came to see an existing technology and think, oh, I'm just asking you, what's the source of genius, really?
Of course.
No, well, I mean, you know, because there are different kinds of innovators. We've got true inventors who are just, you know, out of the box.
I think innovation's about seeing all the things humanity hasn't done yet and saying, I'll take that one and give it a go.
But I think recognizing that something that's already being done over here and being able to see, oh, that could be used here and done differently and make... Do away with.
I think it was what everyone in 3D graphics would consider the normal progression. Mm. We move from triangles. We need to make them smaller to make things look round. Where will polygons end up? Eventually, in the distant future, they're so small, they're like little atoms. Mm. So what science is already using, what medicine is already using, making things out of little points, that is where things are going. I said, well, I think I have a way to bring that distant future... Pull it back through time to now.
And just to clarify, you were saying, you said a couple of times about your data being used to run a city. What you're talking about is giving a kind of virtual representation of the city so that planners and decision makers can access that part of the city. Your data is not actually running Budapest right now.
It doesn't say, I am the data, no. Obey me, O humans.
Just, I think, before we had too many wacko tweets about what your evil data was up to. Now, just to wrap up the skeptics to your claim, everyone faces skeptics when they come up with something new.
I don't think there's any skeptics anymore.
Okay.
Hexagon Corporation, one of the largest geospatial companies of Europe, uses our technology. Leica, French Railways, there's lots. We have a big long list. I think the skeptics have all been asked, what do you think now? No comment.
Mm.
So we're past that point now. That was a few years ago. It was fun.
Yeah, so it was fun. So your suggestion, your advice for people who are at the verge of sounding crazy and having the skeptics come after them, what's your advice for them? Because skepticism is a really important part of it.
I think there's nothing more convincing than the truth combined with enough time.
Mm. Great. I think we'll leave it there, Bruce, if that's really your
name,
Dell. Yeah.
It is.
Well, that's a great name. Nominative determinism at its best.
Join me
in thanking local entrepreneur and head of Euclideon here in Brisbane. We'll be hearing and seeing more of unlimited data, not least of all, at the Gold Coast. Our final speaker in this session...